You see things like high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, even some pediatric cancers are associated with obesity, joint problems, heart disease, all of these things, you know, high cholesterol levels, so on, with obesity. But there's also the psychological aspect of it, is that obese kids are often ostracized, they can't keep up with activities, they have fewer friends, they're made fun of, you know, especially boys, they're bullied a lot, kind of middle school into high school and so on. So the physical consequences of being overweight is the health part of it, but that leads to social and psychological issues, which things like low self-esteem, depression, anxiety, you know, all of those things as well. So it's not just a health issue, but it's also has some psychological ramifications as well, which in some ways is even harder to deal with than physical issues. So here's a chart that I got from the CDC that gives you, this is adult obesity. So you can see all the different states. And you know, one of the highest that you see, you know, Alabama is one of them, 35. This is adult obesity, 35.7. You know, is at the higher end. Louisiana, so of some of the southern states. Michigan, you can see, is not far behind. I mean, 32.5. So we're kind of up there as well. States with lower obesity, Colorado, 22%, District of Columbia, 22%, and so on. So they're the ones that are lower, but you can see a lot of ones, Tennessee, Louisiana, you know, are all pretty much into the mid-30s. So the prevalence is pretty high, and this is self-reported obesity. This is not medically reported or calculated. These are people who are saying, yes, I know I fall into this category of being obese. So you're considered obese if you're in the 95th percentile in weight. So 90th and greater is overweight, and 95th and greater is obese. So these are people who know they're in that category. So this is like even beyond overweight. So before I actually go into these two studies that I wanted to talk about, there's a couple of studies, a little bit of background in this area that I first wanted to cover. So one of the very early studies in this area was by Walton and Johnson, and what they did was, from a developmental perspective, they asked preschoolers about the nutrition and nutrition consequences of different diets. So they would say, you know, if Peter ate, you know, one apple and Polly two, who would be fatter, or something like that, or, you know, or who would grow more. Now, what they found was that kindergartners, preschool-age kids, and even kindergartners had no idea about the differential effects of food. Basically, food equals input, growth equals output. So it doesn't matter what you ate. Even they didn't even recognize that water and food is different. They said if you consume the same amount of water as food, the nutritional benefits are the same. But this was back in the 80s, so this was one of the very first studies. So the reason that any food consumption can lead to an increase in height and weight. Some of the more recent studies, the one by Slaughter and Ting, this was done in Australia, and they had like a fairly large sample of preschoolers through middle childhood age, so about sixth graders. And what they asked different things. They asked about the quantity of food, the effects of different foods, you know, on both on height and weight. And what they also found was pretty much similar results. Younger kids don't understand the differential effects of eating foods. But as they get into fourth, fifth grade, they kind of, at least cognitively, seem to understand that healthy foods probably leads to more growth, and unhealthy foods leads to an increase in weight. Some of my work that I've done, the one in 2014, you know, it was similar. It was only at fourth grade, while we asked kids, like, you know, if somebody eats all their broccoli and this other kid doesn't, who's going to grow? And children, preschool age kids don't recognize the difference. They say it doesn't matter what you eat, you're going to grow, which in some ways makes sense. But again, they don't have that fine differentiation between nutritionally appropriate and inappropriate foods. One of my more recent studies that I've done looked at the impact of genetics. So basically, do kids recognize that certain things like height, okay, there's a strong genetic correlation to height. And there's often a misconception among parents that, you know, if you keep feeding your kids the right food, they'll keep growing. You know, that my kid's just not tall because he's not eating the right food. No, once your child has gotten a certain amount of protein and a nutritionally adequate protein, if you keep excess protein, it gets converted into fat. And they put on weight. So there is only so much you can do when it comes to height. Now with weight, there's a genetic correlation, but it's a lot less, you know, because people, and often, and children recognize this. So preschoolers attribute height more to genetics, which is the birth parents, and but they attribute weight more to the environment. So I found slightly different results. And the way we test this is what we use, what is called a switched at birth test, which means that you know, in order to simplify for kids, you pretty much say this couple had a baby, and after this baby was born, this baby went to live with these other people. So then you say one set of parents was tall, the other one was short. When this baby's 6 years old or 10 years old, or when the baby grows up, is this baby gonna be like these people or these people? So what you're doing is you're basically pitting being tall and being short against each other, one with the biological parents and one with the adoptive parents. And preschoolers tend to associate height more to the biological parents and say, oh, they're going to be more like this. But when it comes to weight, they seem more unsure of it. They seem to think that it could be either, it depends what the child eats, and so on. So you see kind of a mix of results, especially with some of the more recent studies. But if you look at the studies that have been done, it still pretty much shows you that children have this global attribution theory. Like, you know, food equals growth. They really don't see the differentiation there. Now, the reason why this is somewhat peculiar or somewhat, you know, strange is children do get a lot of input from parents about eating. Okay, so for example, Leanne Birch has done a lot of work in this area, and although this focus work is older, what she has done is she's actually tabulated gone in and seen what kind of input children get from their parents about eating. So especially in the first 6 years of a child's life, the mother primarily decides what the child eats, right? And so the mother's dietary knowledge and so on is what is going to determine the child's diet. So adults, what she found was that adults give both accurate and inaccurate information. So for example, you know, they'll say things like, you know, if you eat your vegetables, you'll keep growing tall, okay? But interestingly, they focus on healthy things. You're not going to tell a four-year-old, you know, don't eat candy because you're going to gain weight or it has too much sugar. Often children, parents will say, oh, don't eat too much candy because it's going to give you cavities. But they don't focus on the weight aspect of it. And all the research has shown is obesity is not so much due to the fat consumption, it's due to sugar. That's one of the reasons, that obesity, like children especially who are heavier, have a problem, you know, recognizing what the real cause is, because you know it's almost you don't talk about weight to a four-year-old or a five-year-old, but you talk about the positives, incremental growth, like you know, eat this, it's good for you, it's healthy, and so on. But they also impart inaccurate information. So, for example, when kids ask where does chocolate milk come from, right? You know, parents. She's recorded a lot of parents saying chocolate milk comes from brown cows. Okay, and so those kinds of things, which, you know, for a four-year-old might make sense, but it's not true. The other thing is that kids also learn from their parents, or especially mothers, about what you should eat with what. You don't put ketchup on your apples, okay? Or you don't, you know, you don't put syrup on your pasta. Those kinds of things that sometimes kids will want to do. So the rules of cuisine, what you eat with what. So it's interesting that children are about the benefits of healthy eating, but still, when we test them, it doesn't seem to quite reflect in their cognitive knowledge. Johnson and Maxwell also looked at the media. Okay, children receive a lot of information about eating from the media. So often, not wrong information, but they often make unhealthy foods palatable or appealing to kids. There's one thing called association with food, which is the things is, for example, they put cartoon characters, you know, chicken nuggets like shaped like Mickey Mouse, those kinds of things. Or they'll put pictures of Disney characters, and kids will want to buy that and eat that. They do this with cereals all the time. You know, a lot of children's cereals have high sugar content. But at the same time, they make it appealing, and they use all these other means to get children to eat those. So there's often a lot of advertising that entices kids to unhealthy foods. Even things like apple juice, right? Even organic apple juice, if you look at it, it has almost 6 teaspoons of sugar in it, in one carton. That's a lot for a child to be consuming, and many parents think apple juice is healthy for their children. In some ways, yeah, they're getting it's better than soda, but at the same time, that sugar content is really high in many of these fruit juices as well. So they're getting their information somewhat accurate and inaccurate from their parents, from their, you know, from daycares that they go to and so on, but also a lot from the media. So there've been no systematic studies that really looked at maternal input, you know, formally about what kind of input do mothers give their kids about eating healthy and unhealthy foods. And the reason why we look at mothers is because they're the ones who decide what their kids eat, even, you know, at least up to maybe mid-elementary school. And then it gets harder as your kids get into middle school and stuff, because it's harder to control what they're eating. They eat out more, they're with their peers more, they have independence to choose what they eat. Mothers are the ones who prepare meals, whether you cook meals at home, whether you buy meals, eat out, all of those kinds of things. And maternal nutritional knowledge, okay, this is the other thing as well. Many mothers, especially, many mothers have inaccurate assumptions about what's healthy. Okay, so they don't quite realize the impact of eating candy or chocolates or even ice cream on a daily basis. And that influences the kind of food they feed their children. So, you know, we've had conversations in our class, like, you know, Karen here, that about when you go to a birthday party, right? When your kid, you emphasize all this healthy eating, and then your kid goes to a birthday party and it goes out the window, because what do they have? Pizza, you know, mac and cheese, ice cream, you know, chocolate, stuff like, and stuff, and you have a couple of birthday parties on a weekend, your child would have eaten 6 or 8 slices of pizza. So all that healthy eating that you try to emphasize through the week goes out the window. So that's the other thing too, is, you know, why, and then, you know, and of course kids love pizza or mac and cheese, and that's why they have them at these parties, you know, versus